If you're a disabled visitor to America, and especially if you get to California, Berkeley is the place where you'll feel immediately at ease. People don't stare or deliberately not stare. You're just taken for granted. And you soon begin to realize why Berkeley has been called the Crips capital of the world. Berkeley has always been known as a place where movements for social change have begun. But in the more conservative and relaxed atmosphere of the 1980s, it's hard to remember the scenes of violent confrontation which were typical in the 60s, when students on the Berkeley campus were rioting against the Vietnam War and campaigning for the rights of minorities. It was in that atmosphere of protest that disabled people began to realize that they too were a minority which would have to fight for its civil rights. And so a movement was born. Today, wheelchairs are a commonplace sight on the campus. But 20 years ago, it was very different. So what was it like to be a disabled student at Berkeley in the early 60s?
Well, to start with, you'd have been living in a hospital unit, treated as a medical problem. And apart from going to your classes, that's where you would have stayed. There was no possibility for taking part in ordinary student life. But as the radical movement flowered, a group of these severely disabled students decided to break out, and they called themselves the Rolling Quads. The leader of the Rolling Quads was Ed Roberts, paralyzed by polio when he was 14.
I was the only disabled student on the campus. It was very weird. I was stared at all the time. It was very clear that they didn't want me there. In the beginning, they were afraid I might die or something serious might happen to me. Once we convinced the university that I could go there, they couldn't reject me because of I had high grades. But if we couldn't find a place to live, and we finally found a student health center that I could live in. And I was very much, you know, a bullet student, academic, and doing well, until I began to realize how difficult it was for me to get around the campus. And how many awful attitudes there were on the part of professors. And I think because they started with me, and I was very severely disabled and had an iron lung, they were willing to take anybody after that.
All right, a breakthrough. Thank you. Bye-bye.
For Ed, each bad experience was a further spur to his determination not to be restricted by his disability. And before long, he was to be joined by other disabled students with the same ambitions.
Within 3 or 4 years, there were about 12 of us. We really began to feel that we were fighting for our own independence and that there was a future for us out in the community. We had to really think through how to do it. How were we going to make ourselves free?
At about the same time, across the country in Chicago, Eunice Fiorito, blinded at 16, realized that she too had a fight on her hands if she wanted an equal chance in life. Eunice was to become the first president of the American Coalition of Citizens with Disabilities.
I was a bouncy kid who liked life, and I was concerned about how I was going to live that life. But on the other hand, I was very much certain that I was, and I was going to master it.
Today, Eunice Fiorito is an advisor on disability in the Department of Health and Human Services in Washington.
I finished college in about 3 years. I say that to you only because it was my vocational counselor's position that, in fact, I wasn't ever going to get through college, and I was going to, if you will, be out of school and not have a degree within 3 years. And so I was very delighted when in 3 years I could walk to his office and say, I have this degree and you were wrong. That began to make me aware of how people with disabilities were going to be treated by society. And then I tried to get a job as a teacher in the state of Illinois. And one must consider that this is now back 20 years or better ago. And the state of Illinois said, no, you can't teach, you are blind. You can't handle children, and how will they react to you anyhow? That was the next piece, and I started to hunt for a job, and I couldn't get a job. That then brought to me an awareness of the unfairness, the way people were being discriminated against.
Judy Heumann was in the forefront of the rights movement in New York in the 60s. She's now deputy director of the Center for Independent Living in Berkeley, begun by Ed Roberts, and now a model for similar centers across America.
CIL is an organization which is run by persons with various kinds of disabilities, physical disabilities, blindness, deafness, persons with mental retardation. We have a long history of wanting to not only provide direct services for people, but also to be able to begin to influence policymakers so that they could understand more clearly those policy barriers which prohibit us from being integrated within the community. For myself personally, I became really actively involved in the movement after I had been through a struggle of getting education and continuing to have this image of the American dream. If I worked hard at school and if I really studied and if I did everything that I was told to do, I would be able to go out and then get a job and I would be able to, you know, be Miss Middle Class America living in suburbia if I wished to do that. But in reality, what happened was every step of the way was a real struggle. And even once I had gotten through university and gotten my degree to teach, I was then discriminated against specifically because of my disability. So at some point within me, I had to acknowledge the fact that no matter how hard I worked, I was still not viewed as an equal person. And if I could accept not being viewed as an equal person, then I could kind of slide away into the background. But I couldn't accept that for myself.
What did you do about it?
Well, I began working a lot with other disabled people. I had for a number of years been friends with disabled people, but we hadn't been as political as we became. And what's happened over the last 10 years in this country is that disabled people have begun to band much more closely together to form what I would define as the movement.
Ralph Hotchkiss, who designs wheelchairs, and his wife Debbie Kaplan, a civil rights lawyer, became involved in the disability movement in Washington in the early 70s.
Well, when I first became disabled, now 15 years ago, I got involved right away in technology of disability. I was a bicycle maker and I almost had to fix my wheelchair first weekend out. But I didn't get involved in politics for another 5 years afterwards. Then I was working for Ralph Nader in auto safety, and all these disabled people started writing him letters, and he asked me to find out what was going on. I did. Met Judy Heumann, who you must have talked to by now, and got involved in some of the early demonstrations, setting up in Washington, D.C.
Can you tell me about those early demonstrations? What part did you both take?
Debbie wasn't disabled yet.
I was just becoming disabled at that point in California. With that, a year out of college, I had a diving accident and broke my neck, and found myself in the world of disabled people. And I remember the first thing I wanted to do when I was in the rehabilitation hospital was to find out from other disabled people what the world was really like for people with disabilities, how people functioned on the outside, what it was that made some people have independent lifestyles. And the hospital really didn't do much to provide that. And one of the groups that came to visit us was a group of the people who originated the Center for Independent Living called the Rolling Quads. And it was through people like that who were strong role models for me in my identity as a person with a disability that really got me involved.
The movement had now begun to coalesce as disabled people all over America decided that they had to take action and demand access to buildings and transport and education. They wanted jobs, housing, and adequate funding and services to get them out of institutions. They wanted the equal opportunity which they believed was their right under the American Constitution, and a fighting chance to prove themselves as useful members of society.
I started in the civil rights movement. I started working with black and Chicano civil rights. And somehow in the middle of that, when things were going very well, I stopped and I said, what am I doing here? I've learned all these great organizing skills and I should be working with my own people. And that was a transition. We realized we could do it ourselves, that we needed some support, that we needed to make the social systems, like the welfare system that paid for our attendance and basic support, that had to work for us, not against us. So we had to, that way we had to get involved with the state legislature to change the rules and regulations and to change the laws so that it promoted independence rather than maintenance independence.
In 1975, Ed Roberts became director of California's Department of Rehabilitation, serving over 100,000 disabled people.
One of the conditions that I took, the director of rehabilitation, was that I would have the freedom to be the advocate and to be out front on issues that even the governor and the administration may not agree with me on. But I had to have that freedom to be the out front advocate in this movement. And that I couldn't be limited by some archaic notion of what it means to be a director of a large agency.
Ed's department has a budget of $150 million and a staff of over 2,000. Over the years, the concept of rehabilitation has changed from finding jobs for physically handicapped people to a positive policy of non-discrimination aimed at integration for all handicapped people. That policy was enshrined in the Rehabilitation Act, introduced during the Nixon administration in 1972.
The Rehabilitation Act was a most progressive piece of legislation when reviewed at the time and would have opened many doors for our independence. The administration in 1972, however, I believe, and so did many other disabled people, believe that this administration felt that the piece of legislation that was then being proposed, which then included programs of independent living, what they called client advocacy programs for people to exercise their right to get what they felt that they were justly deserving of in order to be functional citizens, were much too progressive. And President Nixon at that time vetoed the bill. We then felt, and I think we were ready to realize, that we had to take command of our own lives and become political.
When the Rehab Act was vetoed by President Nixon, it was done about a week and a few days before the 72 elections with Nixon and McGovern. And a group of us from Disabled in Action, a number of other organizations, decided that we wanted to do something publicly about it. So we organized within not many days a demonstration, which started out in Manhattan at what was called the Federal Building. We'd never been there before, and we took 60 or 80 people up to this Federal Building. And when we got up there, it was like in the middle of no place. It was on this little island. And we had this demonstration, and we had these great flyers, and we had this symbolic funeral of disabled people being killed by the Nixon administration. And the next thing we knew, out came these city police. They drove up in this car, and they asked who the leader was, and people sent them over to me. And the guy said to me, "Do you know that you're trespassing on federal property?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Are you going to leave?" And I said, "No." And we expected the world to end, and he said, "So stay," and he turned around and he walked away. So we decided we weren't making the impact that we wanted to, so we were going to sit down in the street and we were going to stop traffic. So we did. We all went out most of us went out into the street, but as I said, there were hardly any cars coming by. So we all got into our vans and into the cars, and there we traipsed off to Madison Avenue, which in Manhattan is it's a huge street. And we got out of the cars, and we decided that what we were going to do is we were going to sit down in the street. So at 4:30 in the afternoon, we formed this huge circle. We cut off four streets. But that was too scary because there were only 60 or 80 of us, and there were huge trucks and cars. Manhattan is like a crazy city in the best of times. And so we decided that we would retreat. We would only go onto one street. But still, we shut the whole city down. They were announcing paraplegic stop traffic in Manhattan, and the police went and got a representative from Nixon headquarters, and they wanted to know what we wanted. We said we wanted a public debate with the president on national TV to debate why he had vetoed the Rehab Act. The guy thought we were totally crazy. He just walked away going, "You're crazy, you're crazy."
That was one of the biggest, was when Nixon did veto the Rehab Act on one of the snowiest days in Washington's history. many people, over 100, I believe, came down from New York City in buses and basically stormed the Capitol, visited all their congressmen and all the congressmen who had voted against it, and built up enough support so that I believe that was the strongest congressional override in history, override of a presidential veto.
Finally, on September the 23rd, 1973, Nixon signed. The Rehabilitation Act was now law, but there was yet another hurdle to be overcome.
In this country, when a law is passed, there must be followed then regulations which really explain the law and set forth the actual policy and the practices of how that policy is going to be interpreted. Well, that did not come about, particularly within Section 504.
Section 504 states, no otherwise qualified handicapped individual in the United States shall, solely by reason of his handicap, be excluded from the participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any program or activity receiving federal financial assistance.
It was 1975, and there were no regulations. And we proceeded then to come into 1976, and there were still no regulations, and therefore the law was not being implemented.
January 1977. A new president in the White House. But instead of new hope, yet more frustration, as Jimmy Carter's administration delayed the regulations yet again.
Within 2 days after the new Carter administration was put into place, about 15 of us came to see then Secretary Califano, stating the issue about the regulations not having been issued, and expressing our concern and desire to work with him and his staff to get them out within a reasonable period of time, particularly since they had been circulated, people had studied them, they had commented, etc., etc. That process then started all over again. The administration decided they wanted to review them and they wanted to study them. And we went back and forth to meeting after meeting after meeting in good faith. And we finally said to them, look, we have had enough. From a legal point of view, these regulations seem to have been quite good. You've studied them and we've studied them. If you cannot come up with a decision, we must then take action. And we gave them to the 4th of April. And on the 4th of April of 1977, they did not have the regulations ready for issuance. And so we had developed an alternate plan. And that plan was to bring our plight to the attention of the people of this country.
The key part of the plan was to take over federal government office buildings across the USA. And in the full spotlight of press and TV attention, Judy Heumann expressed the deeply felt frustration of the disabled minority.
The harassment, the lack of equity that has been provided for disabled individuals, and that now is even being discussed by the administration, is so intolerable that I can't quite put it into words. I can tell you that every time you raise issues of separate but equal, the outrage of disabled individuals across country is going to continue. It is going to be ignited. There will be more takeovers of buildings until finally maybe you begin to understand our position. We will no longer allow the government to oppress disabled individuals. We want the law enforced. We want no more segregation. We will accept no more discussion of segregation. And I would appreciate it if you would stop shaking your head in agreement when I don't think you understand what we are talking about.